Good morning. I've been waiting to find out for some time how the former leader of the NDP in Ontario is enjoying his position as Canada's ambassador to the United Nations, now that he has lost his political purity, and I might say political virginity, and finds himself embroiled, whether he likes it or not, in the patronage squabbles of Brian Mulroney, or Mulragan, which might be a better name for Brian Mulroney. And what our ambassador to the United Nations feels about the Caspar Weinberger fiasco, and our situation in this delicate balance of friendship and independence with the United States. He is, of course, Stephen Lewis, and I can't resist to mention son of David Lewis, but he is, of course, his own man. That's one target this morning. The other target this morning is a delightful target. For once, I'm going to be positive and approving and full of approbation as I fly in my helicopter over the magnificent Canada Harbour Place on time, on target, and on budget. A magnificent addition badly needed to the waterfront in Vancouver as our permanent reminder that we are the Pacific Rim and here's the greatest cruise ship facility on the coast. But first, Stephen Lewis after the break. I'm going to call you Stephen when we're talking politics and Mr. Ambassador when we're talking the United Nations. How's that for a compromise?
It's entirely up to you. I answer to both.
You answer to both. Let's get the politics out of the way, first of all. Do you not have little nightmares of regret that you sacrificed what Maclean's called your ideological purity to take a job from this man Mulroney, who's demonstrating some considerable lack of independence from the United States?
I had no nightmares at all. I made a conscious decision. I didn't sacrifice ideological purity. I'm still a democratic socialist. I'm working in a different arena. That's the shift.
But your freedom to speak is very much restricted by your responsibilities as Canada's UN ambassador.
My freedom to speak is not a feckless exercise, that's right, but my freedom to speak within the reasonable flexibility of Canadian foreign policy is considerable, Jack. I don't feel as though I'm shackled.
Did I understand you to say that freedom to speak can be a feckless exercise?
Well, it used to be for me. I used to engage in rhetorical spasms every day.
Oh, political hyperbole of the left.
Absolutely.
And now you're a balanced speaker for the middle.
Now I'm solemn and responsible.
Solemn. But now, let's get right down to Casey's effort. When all this stuff goes on about patronage, you obviously were a token appointment to clean Mulroney's skirts for his other flagrant liberal-type patronage.
I didn't make the appointment. I just accepted it. And the fact of the matter is that there have been other appointments. As a matter of fact, the day I was appointed, Doug Roach was appointed.
And
now, he's a conservative, but he was a Tory who stood and voted against his own party on the cruise missile and has had a whole tradition which is antithetic to some of the traditional Tory views.
And then there was the ex-speaker sent to Portugal or something.
All right, and there was the head of the Council on the Status of Women.
And then
who is a New Democrat, I remind you.
But now he is shoveling out the appointments in the old pork barrel manner, a la Air Canada, etc. You can't be blamed for that.
Certainly not.
We'll forgive you for that particular
thank
one.
Thank you very much. My ideological purity there is intact.
But now I'm now going to put you. Were you not appalled by the statement made by Caspar Weinberger on CTV last week that some of the missiles which might be launched under the new North radar might be here? And then the censor of the transcript, was that not appalling?
The censoring of the transcript was appalling, if it was a censoring, and the views of Caspar Weinberger, I watched them that morning, were unsettling, but they were also rejected later in the day by the Minister of State for External Affairs. You know, people in Canada have to decide whom they're going to trust. Are they going to trust Caspar Weinberger to speak for this country, or are they going to trust our own politicians to speak for this country? I prefer to trust our own politicians.
Ah, but if you were to, I put the question differently and say to me, who is the effective controller of these things? I would say not our politicians, the American politicians.
No, sir, I think you're wrong, Jack. I don't think the American politicians have any such control. They may have ambitions for what they deem should be Canadian policy, but they have no such control.
Well, we had the admission again the other day by the Prime Minister in the House of Commons that there are certain surrendering of parts of our sovereignty. For instance, cabinet ministers in Canada need permission to visit some of our dual-line bases because they're American-controlled.
But aren't those constant bilateral relationships amongst countries. I mean, countries enter into those kinds of agreements all the time.
I didn't know that, in fact. Well, maybe I'm indulging in the kind of political rhetoric you would use where you're in the opposition.
That is conceivable.
In fact, that is dead on.
All right.
Are you gratified? Do you feel that the cause of the world peace is greatly improved by the North Canada radar and by the testing of cruise missiles on Canadian soil?
Jack Webster, the testing of the cruise and the consummation of the North Radar Agreement are an extension of policies that have been in place for a number of years. I never supported the testing of the cruise as a democratic socialist. I never supported the vote against the nuclear freeze. But within the United Nations, we pursue a number of very important initiatives which are not given enough attention. We support the comprehensive test ban, the prohibition of chemical weapons, the non-proliferation treaty, the non-militarization of outer space, and we do it toughly and resolutely, and it attaches to the pressure that is placed on the superpowers.
And you are given your instructions as to what your policy and attitude will be on these matters.
Well, one has a general policy. Within that policy, you can put things vigorously or you can put them with passivity. We put them vigorously. You sound skeptical.
Well, no, I'm not skeptical, but if Joe Clark runs into a big problem over some particular thing, you can't step out of line. If he changes his policy, you change your policy.
Ultimately, the government makes policy, of course. No one can deny it.
How long do you have this job for?
I don't know.
Oh, it's at the pleasure of?
It's at the pleasure of Prime Minister Mulroney.
Allow me to do, in memory of Gordon Sinclair, a simple question. How much money do you get?
I get $75,000 a year.
But how much in expenses?
Well, there is a hospitality budget, which obviously you need at a mission in New York when you're dealing with other ambassadors.
You like it, anyway.
I love it.
It bars you forever from a return to live, active partisan politics.
Well, Jack, I didn't want to return to live active partisan.
It.
I'd had it. I'd been in the legislature for 15 long years.
That's right. Heartbreaking years.
No, they were gratifying years. I loved politics.
Knowing full well that the NDP can never make it in Ontario.
I'm not so sure, but knowing full well that you have to have infinite patience.
And you had run out of infinite patience.
Does
your old party have a leader in Ontario just now?
It sure as the devil has a fellow named Bob Ray.
Bob Ray.
All right. Boy, you are a scoundrel.
Oh.
And he is, as you know, an extraordinarily bright fellow who's about to become the leader of the opposition in Ontario.
I know. I'm going to talk about the UN in a moment or two, but I mean, I must draw on your political expertise. You and I both know that Broadbent wants to get out, don't we?
I'm not so sure at all. I think he's beginning to enjoy it a second time around.
He's certainly taking much of the attention from the Liberals in the House at the moment.
Well, you'll remember after the results of the last federal election, he said that the NDP would be the real opposition, and that is now, in my view, emerging.
That's a good NDP statement, isn't it?
And isn't that odd? Here I am working for a Tory government, and I can say this kind of thing to you.
Well, I want you to demonstrate
the smidgen of independence.
That still remains to you. Now, next thing. Do you see much of Joe?
Yes.
How's he doing?
I think he's doing reasonably well. He's terrifically under assault day in and day out. That takes its toll. I'm sure he's weary. Do you like Joe Clark?
I find Joe, as a matter of fact, in the last election when Mulroney wouldn't talk because the pollsters wouldn't allow him to be questioned, you see. You just have a dummy created by Norman Atkins going around the country on photo opportunities. Joe Clark was the best political interview I had during the entire campaign last year.
He has a directness, a candor. He's a decent man. I'm enjoying working with him.
One other question I can't resist. Did you watch that disgusting display of Reagan and Mulroney and Canada Council's Maureen Forrester on television?
I was on the road, I'm happy to say,
so I couldn't observe
it all. No, I saw Maureen Forrester. I could hardly believe my eyes, inviting them down to sing together.
Did you see the joke about the red phone?
No, I didn't see the
joke. She picked up a red phone, which can cause the end of the world, and said, "Oh, Mr. Reagan, we have a call. Oh, it's Mr. Volcker. Oh, the dollar's gone out of sight again. Even NASA can't find it."
Well, that's Canadian humor.
Oh, just appalling. Next, the United Nations and famine. Bernie Simpson, if you're listening. After the break. Is the United Nations still clearly split into its three groups, the left, the right, and the third world?
It has pretty strong regional groupings, yeah. You feel it every day, and you particularly feel it from the non-aligned countries who are aggravated with both sides.
How long have you been down there now?
Not really more than 5 or 6 months.
For those of us who just take the UN as a collection of little insignia, and they appear every now and again, can you tell me something that the UN has achieved in the months you've been down there that can make you tell me it's a wonderful thing, it's effective, it's good?
Sure, sure. I can point to the centerpiece of the United Nations activity for the last few months, and that's the mobilization of aid for the relief of famine in Africa. It has been a magnificent demonstration by an international body.
Well, I thought it was the BBC television or the CBC television that put it on the screen, and that suddenly wakened up some of the have nations and some of the Eastern nations to their conscience and responsibility.
As a matter of fact, you're right, but it is worth noting that the Secretary General of the United Nations made the forecast of what would happen in December of 1983, Jack, and no one listened. And successively through 1984, UN agencies begged the world to intervene and no one listened. It was not until the television cameras went in on October the 7th that finally the world turned.
But is it the United Nations that does it, or is it merely the individual nations? Russia, I believe, is very active in Ethiopia.
In Ethiopia itself,
with aid?
Yes. Well, with logistics support, as they call it, with helicopters and lorries to transport the aid. Not much aid itself.
And what does the United Nations do, though? It doesn't supply money for food, does it?
Oh, yes. The United Nations supplies direct money through the World Food Program and through UNICEF and through the United Nations Development Program. The UN mobilizes and coordinates all of the aid that is going through those countries. It has a key person who coordinates the contributions of the non-governmental organizations, of the governments, of all the people who are involved.
Is it not, said he cynically, a pointless exercise whereby we are feeding people on an emergency basis for another month or another 6 months or another year, but none of the root causes being tackled?
But it's never a pointless exercise to keep those people alive. You agree with that.
Oh, yeah.
The question is, can you speak to the long term down the road? And increasingly, partly through the debates that occur in the United Nations, countries are beginning to think about the long term.
Are you not just back from the Anglo-Egyptian Sudan, but it's the Sudan.
It is the Sudan, yes, about 2.5 weeks ago.
They also have a massive problem.
They have an unbelievable problem because they not only have all of those refugee populations on the borders, the Ethiopians pouring across on the east, the Chadians pouring across on the west, the Ugandans moving north from the south, 1.25 million refugees, but they also have 5 to 6 million Sudanese in the center of the country who are on the brink of starvation.
What happened? Guerrilla warfare entirely caused it?
No.
Because when I was there at the end of the war, it was a magnificently fertile country with no starvation whatsoever.
Jack, when I visited Africa, West and East Africa, for a couple of years after I left university, the entire continent was fertile. This is a progressive deterioration caused partly by the prevalence of drought, partly by the encroachment of the desert, mostly by the economic policies pursued by the African countries themselves, encouraged by the Western world, which have destroyed the agricultural base.
The colonies did a better job of feeding people.
Well,
the old colonial empires.
Yeah, but it did a lousy job of giving people human rights. So when they came to independence, this damnable bond was further exploited afterwards. And the African countries were told, you've got to build an infrastructure, you've got to have monuments, you've got to have armies, you've got to have all of the apparatus of the modern state.
You've got to have gold bedsteads.
All right, that was only once in Ghana.
But that happened.
Kwame Nkrumah's berserk Minister of Agriculture.
But we know perfectly well that many of the African leaders, under the guise of independence, imposed totalitarian regimes on their poor subjects.
Well, there were one-party states which were a direct consequence of the remnants of colonial rule, Jack. But set that aside
Back
for a moment.
Back to the starvation.
Back to the starvation. They all had the trappings of the modern state. And in order to have the trappings of the modern state, they needed money. And so they turned their agricultural land into cash crops like cotton and coffee and sisal, exported to the Western world. They get the money, and then they need more and more, and they take the land out of production for their own people. And that is the primary cause of the decline. And now they're so in debt that anything they sell just pays the interest.
Harcourt has a famine fund, which is doing quite well. I promised to say that it was up to $900,000, and they're convinced that one little push would put it over $1 million, which is the target of Harcourt and Bernie Simpson and the others running it. You want to give it a plug?
Yeah, I think it should go over $1 million today. There is an Ethiopian lunch today, as it were, an empty plate lunch in order to rally the business community to give that extra little bit. Jack, there's no city in Canada that I know of which has done what Vancouver is doing. It's extraordinary.
Mm-hmm. Now, back to business. UNESCO.
Right.
I presume that we will follow the tail of the American dog and eventually pull out of UNESCO as they are apparently planning so to do.
Don't assume it. They're already out. But don't assume it.
What does UNESCO mean again?
United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization. And they do some excellent stuff on scientific and cultural matters. First
rate. Why have the Americans pulled out?
The Americans pulled out because they allege that UNESCO is badly run, that it's too ideological, over-politicized, and that the executive director is incompetent. He is a brooding megalomaniac. I'm not sure he's incompetent. It's worrying. He's not the kind of person who should be leading a specialized agency, in my opinion. And they do have problems.
Have you made a recommendation to the Canadian government as to what our policy should be? Because the Americans do want us. I believe the British are now considering pulling out, aren't they?
Yes, they are. They've given notice.
And how about the Canadians? Are we just going to sit on the fence and do nothing?
No, we're not sitting on the fence. We are working determinedly to reform UNESCO from within. We will wait until the fall when there are a package of reforms being presented, and I hope that they will then work. I don't want Canada to pull out unless there's no alternative, because if you start peeling off from a universal organization, you do it great damage.
What is that? You'll tell me the status is great, but what are the big problems that you have to deal with? Are we on the middle on the Palestine problem, the Israeli problem?
The Middle East is intractable. It's absolutely impossible of solution unless the powers themselves agree to negotiate. And the UN can't impose that on countries.
All right. Are we going to go along with the Americans on their support for the Nicaraguans and their support of the guerrillas in the Salvador and Guatemala?
Jack, as a matter of fact, we have been good on Central America. We have supported the Contadora process every step of the way. And unless the Contadora treaty works, the prognosis for Central America is awful. You know that. You would agree to that.
I get confused. I know that Nicaragua is the anti-democratic government.
So-called, according to the United States, the Marxist government.
That's right.
As they term it.
And that Salvador and Guatemala are
closer to the United States.
Yeah, closer to
Costa Rica, Honduras, etc. What has happened is that the Contadora initiative, which is primarily promoted by Mexico and Venezuela and Panama, is an effort to demilitarize all of Central America and to have verification monitors there to keep the lid on. And that looks as though it is the most realistic hope, and we've gone right down the line with Contadora. We haven't moved an inch from promoting that solution.
And Canada's position is right.
I think it's absolutely right. We even went to Mexico and worked on the verification clauses of the treaty.
And if it were an NDP government, it would still be that position.
It would still be that position. There'd probably be more rhetorical criticism of the United States over Nicaragua, but that would be the position.
We've time for some calls now to Stephen Lewis, former leader of the NDP, Canada's United Nations ambassador, and a very bright fellow too, I might tell you, after the break. Okay, Canada's ambassador to the United Nations. Go ahead to him, please.
Yes, sir. I'd just like to mention a few things about the American conduct. There were some incidences regarding the CIA and doing psychological tests up here without the knowledge or consent of the Canadian government. I feel that the Canadian government as such is basically intimidated by the Americans, and I think that if the Americans considered a first strike was on the way, they would come into our country and willingly just march in.
That's a good point. Do you feel that Canadians are entitled to think that we really are pawns in the game? And Weinberger seemed to make it clear, well, we'll do what we have to do in times of real emergency.
Listen, if there's a first strike on the way, it doesn't matter at that point what happens, because we'll all be annihilated in any event. But truth is, we are not pawns of the Americans. We have every right to reject whatever they intend for us if we wish to do so. And as I understand it, the government doesn't share the enthusiasm of Weinberger.
Mm-hmm. That was a bad one. Go ahead, please.
Mr. Ambassador.
Yes, sir.
What ethical and moral value is what credibility, if any, has a self-confessed political schizophrenic? If your so-called ideological purity is still very much intact, as you say it is, then how long can it be until you go into your anti-American and pro-Canadian Socialist Act and shaft the U.S. and its allies in a concerted vote with your Third World and Warsaw Pact pals at the U.N.
Don't spoil your question by making it any longer. That was beautiful.
Was it?
Yes.
If you accuse me of schizophrenia, I'm listening to ambulatory paranoia. don't panic, sir. If I ever attack the Americans, the Prime Minister will remove me from office. So I'll still maintain balance.
Give me that again.
I'm obviously not at liberty to sound off in a willful personal way.
Yeah, but didn't you like that question? That was a good heckling question.
It was a good heckling question, I agree. But I thought he was starting from the left wing and he ended up on the right wing.
No, he was taking you as an extreme socialist for the purpose of his little dialogue, saying, therefore, being a socialist, ipso facto, you're in bed with Moscow and Warsaw and whatnot.
Well,
I thought it was rather a clever question. Go ahead, please.
Well, Ambassador Lewis.
Yes.
I'd be interested to know what you feel about Canada's role in the United Nations conference on the law of the sea, and whether you can see anything really happening without the Americans signing.
Well, you're quite right. Without the Americans signing and certain other countries, there's a great deal of difficulty. I don't know whether you know it, but Canada was, in a sense, one of the chief architects of the law of the sea over the 10 years of negotiations. Our ambassador, a chap named Beasley, had an extraordinary amount to do with the actual drafting of every single section. And I think we're trying very hard behind the scenes to persuade everyone to ratify and get it in place. We have our own problems with some of the clauses, but don't give up hope. It's gone for 10 years. Maybe after 15, it'll be in place.
Did I ask a question? Give me one paragraph on what will be the effect of the law of the sea if it's ratified.
The law, if it's ratified, it will serve to protect the resources in the sea from exploitation indiscriminately by individual countries.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, I'd like to ask the gentleman that you have on. There was somebody that phoned in and said that we were pawns of the U.S. with the CIA. Are we really pawns of the United States, or is it with foreign countries? Because Trudeau has always supported the foreign countries. That's my question.
Are we really pawns of the United States?
No, we're not pawns of the United States. And the reference to what the CIA did, it must be 30 years ago now. And it was awful behavior at the time, unforgivable behavior at the time. But it is not characteristic of the present relationship between Canada and the U.S.
That was when they subsidized the doctor in Montreal who conducted LSD experiments on people for their purposes.
Right, including the wife of David Orlico, the member of parliament in Winnipeg North. And I know it personally. It's a deeply painful thing they did, but it's not true now.
Go ahead from Courtney.
Yes, good morning, Jack. Be appropriate for me to go back to the drought in Africa?
Yes, of course.
Yes. When Prime Minister Mulroney went to Moscow for Chernenko's funeral, I think it would have been more appropriate for him to have dropped a message with Chernenko and a challenge to compete with the United States in eradicating starvation in Africa than going along with the Star Wars deal. What do you think of that?
Well, I don't know what was said between them exactly, but you're quite right in sort of the broader principle. It would be a godsend for Africa if the Soviet Union gave the kind of money which Western countries give. The Soviet Union doesn't do so. It sometimes is shamed into providing support systems like delivery vehicles and helicopters and planes, but you're absolutely right, they do not give food aid, and that is moral delinquency of the worst kind.
Yeah, and of course, you'll agree that your erstwhile socialist friends in the House of Commons are quite convinced that the dual-line upgrade means that we are in the Star Wars with Reagan.
Well, that has been categorically denied, and I read Jeff Simpson's column in the Globe and Mail yesterday, and I noticed that Jeff said that there is no relationship necessarily between SDI and the North radar system.
Go ahead from Cranbrook.
Yes, Mr. Ambassador, in spite of Jack Webster's skepticism, I'd like to compliment you on the job you're doing.
I think you're
like the phoenix rising out of the ashes of an incredible credibility problem. I think you're doing great. And I'd also like to compliment you on your use of the English language. It's nice to hear English spoke as it should be. I think your delivery could be used as an example in our schools because you're not pontifical and you don't talk down. I personally am a great fan of yours. Thank you.
You're very kind. I didn't know I had such a friend in Cranbrook.
You've got many.
I didn't know you had so many close relatives in BC.
What a vile slander.
We're not related, Jack.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, Mr. Ambassador.
Yes.
I'd like to ask you about CETA. It seems to me their prime objective is to spend as much money as possible. And where can we spend more money than what we've got? In other words, we must spend more this year so we'll get more next year. And I think it's not too well run and should be investigated.
Will you forgive me if I say vigorously that you're absolutely wrong, that in fact CETA is one of the best international aid agencies in the world that operates as an arm of government. It has one of the most creative and imaginative directors, presidents, I've ever seen, Maggie Catley Carlson. And as one travels around the world and sits at the center in the United Nations, CETA has an extraordinary reputation. We don't impose conditions on countries that are unrealistic. We dispatch the aid on the ground and manage it well. And in fact, we don't keep asking for more. We have a limited budget and we use it resourcefully. And Canada's aid program is celebrated everywhere. That's one of the reasons we have such respect at the UN.
Well, one of the things that I think we're probably inclined to do is criticize the Americans so freely. And yet without them, many of the countries who are starving would be starving because the Russians sure won't come up and give it to them, nor will the Middle East countries.
That's absolutely true. In fact, in the Sudan, of the 1,400,000 metric tons of grain they need to stay alive in 1985, the Americans are supplying almost a million.
Well,
so you're
sir,
quite right.
May I say in closing, why don't you say sometime at the UN, congratulations or a little bouquet to the Americans because they're the greatest living people in the world.
Well, I don't know whether they're the greatest living people in the world. I always thought that attribute attached to Canadians, but I'll give them a bouquet now and again if you want.
Your plan for today is this starvation lunch?
The starvation lunch and then a speech later on at the university in the afternoon.
Well, my thanks to Stephen Lewis, Canada's ambassador to the United Nations. And I suspect that he has retained his ideological purity within the limits of his instructions from Orwell.
Do I sully your reputation if I say I enjoyed it?
No.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Jack.
Next, Webster's flyabout, walkabout at Canada Harbour Place after the break.
This is going to be one of the glories of the Pacific coast of North America. I'm just approaching the Canada Harbour Place, and all the posturing and backbiting is gone. The whole place is on time, on schedule, on budget. And you know what it is. Remember, it used to be the old burned out Pier BC. And then it was going to be Gracie's and Slipper. And then it became, perhaps more by good luck than good judgment, Canada Harbour Place, a $300 million cruise ship, convention center, and magnificent hotel complex to be ready for opening, and it will be, the same day as Expo, May the 2nd, 1986. And when Expo is over, it will become a truly magnificent cruise ship and convention center. The Teflon sails on top of the cruise ship make it comparable, if not more gracious, than the famous structure in Sydney Harbour in Sydney, Australia. And we're going to land down here, and we're going to take you on a Webster walkabout and explain to you why there have been no union problems on this particular job, why they're managing to be on time and on budget, and give you an advanced look at the glories of Canada Harbour Place.
Well, I'm on the ground from the helicopter now, and the first thing I've got to do is find out the scoundrel who's making a fool of my accent by having that notice up there as if I ever said Webster. Anyway, I'm Webster. And we're going to take you on a tour of Canada Harbour Place. And we're going to start with the Pan Pacific Vancouver Hotel. 500 odd rooms, they tell me. $100 million. And here is Herb Gruder of the Tokyo Corporation.
That's correct.
If I say Tokyo Corporation, I'm
Tokyo.
Wrong.
It is Tokyo. Tokyo is correct, yes.
Tokyo are the people building what?
That's true.
Building, what are you building here?
We're building the Pan Pacific Hotel. We're building the World Trade Center office building complex underneath the hotel.
Now, I want the truth. Is it on time? Is it on schedule?
It is on schedule. It is on budget also.
All the way through?
Yes. At this moment, it still is, and we hope to it will continue that way.
Can I make a little joke?
Yes.
Your accent reminds me very strongly of Victor Borgia. It does.
I heard that before, yes.
Yeah, I've heard that before. Here's an old friend of mine who's turned up from faraway places in the East, Steve Halliday. Steve, last time I saw you, you were at the Bayshore.
That's right. That was 6 years ago.
And then?
Then I went to Toronto, and then I went to Edmonton, and here I am in beautiful British Columbia.
You pulled it off. You came back home.
I came back home.
And you are the general manager.
Yes, sir.
Of this gorgeous, lavish, lush,
beautiful
project.
Hotel.
Okay, let's go and see the hotel. Come on, gentlemen. We'll go this way. You're going to clean up all this mess before the hotel opens.
Yes.
Right, let's get off. Hey, this isn't a permanent elevator, is it?
No, not.
What's your name?
Vic Menini.
Vic what?
Menini.
Menini. Now, Steve. Steve, where do we go? Where are we now?
We're on the level where guests will check in, Jack, and this is the level where the lobby bar is, the all-day restaurant, and the ballroom is over in this area over here, where guests will be able to convene up to 500 persons. We just walk right through here. This is the pre-function area where you'll have cocktails and...
I'm sorry, no thank you. Not at this time
of
day.
Not at this time of the day.
I don't drink, no.
It's a little... you might have to duck a little bit, Jack, through the...
How big is the hotel altogether in terms of thousands of square feet or whatever?
Well, the whole hotel is 505 rooms, and as far as the... square footage, I don't have that figure on the tip of my tongue, but
don't
it is...
Don't really need it anyway,
it is a large area.
Is this the ballroom on our left, or what?
No, the ballroom's back there. This is the open atrium, looking down into the lobby, and there's a beautiful waterfall, which we have a rendering of, and we'll show you in a minute.
Now, we're heading towards the reception desk,
this
are we
is,
now?
This is where we're going to check in, Jack. And what type of room would you like? Suite?
Well, I'd like one with a suite, and I want a whirlpool, and I want a sauna, and I want a good, modest rate.
How did you know we had all that?
Well, I was just guessing.
It's good. This is the type of accommodation we have right in the very, very top floor.
Is it going to be totally luxury all the way, this hotel?
Totally luxurious all the way.
Totally luxurious 100%. All the way. Ah, what do we have here?
This, Jack, is the entrance to our all-day restaurant called Cafe Pacifica. And this is where guests will be able to have breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and it seats 220 customers.
But you haven't got any bookings at all yet.
Well, no, but we're already taking reservations for that. We have a dim sum kitchen and counter in there where we're going to serve dim sum food.
Well, it takes a little bit of imagination, but I can't even see the waterfall you're going to have.
Well, come on over here, and we'll show you the waterfall.
Show me the waterfall.
This, Herb will be able to explain this very unique water conversation feature that we have here in the lobby.
Okay, let's turn around to the camera so we can see your face while you're telling us. This is the waterfall?
Well, it's the lobby lounge.
Yeah. Actually, the water feature consists out of several components. One is starting outside, running into this lobby here, and we have inside the lobby, we have a coastal feature, which is the coastal feature of Japan, China, up to Australia, and then we have on the other side of the Pacific Ocean, we have Alaska all the way down to Mexico.
Do you mean plants and trees and
no.
things?
No. We have the coastal feature, which is the coastal line of the Pacific Rim countries.
An outline map of the Pacific
correct.
Rim countries.
It's a symbol of the objective of the project, which is to promote trade and friendship among countries of the Pacific Rim.
Of the Pacific Rim. Yeah. Very impressive, I'm sure.
The waterfall Steve mentioned is down there. It goes down to the next level below. This next to the escalators here. There's a substantial waterfall which goes down from this level to the next level down below.
Another representation of the waterfall.
Yes.
Okay, we've seen as much as we can here at the moment. Where should we go now?
Why don't we go upstairs and see one of our guest rooms?
Lovely.
Okay, let's go.
Okay, this way to the guest room. Now, Steve Halliday, you keep talking about all-day restaurants. Whatever happened to the coffee shops we used to have in hotels?
Jack, we don't call them coffee shops anymore. They're called all-day restaurants.
Just a minute. Hey, don't go away. What are you doing today?
Putting in the fire sprinklers.
The fire sprinklers?
Yeah.
Your name?
Joe McQuaid.
Your union?
Yep.
Which union?
170, Plumbers Pipefitters.
Oh, good job, this.
Yeah, it's a pretty good job.
How long have you been working on it?
Since January.
January?
Yeah.
And you'll be kept going for a while yet, eh?
Probably, hopefully.
Well, how many? You don't know how many sprinklers you're putting in, do you?
Oh, geez, I think there's about 10,000 in the whole building.
I was going to say 9,369. Okay, thanks very much, Joe. What about your buddy up there? Can we see him?
Hi.
Come on down for a minute. Oh, here's another one I can chat. Where did you get that haircut?
You like that, eh?
Yeah, what's your name?
Carl Clark.
Union Carl, are you a plumber?
No, I'm an elevator worker.
Elevator worker. How has this been as a job to work on?
Pretty good.
Good job.
Up, yeah.
Lots of overtime.
Cold. Not for me.
Not much in the way of overtime.
Not for me.
Where are you from?
Coquitlam.
Coquitlam. Best of luck.
Thanks.
Your buddy here, your name?
Pete Tomsek.
Pete?
Yes.
And what's your union?
Plumbers and Pipefitters, Local 170.
You're another man putting in one of the 10,000 sprinklers.
Yeah, I'm one of them.
How have you enjoyed working on this one?
Oh, it's fine. Good job.
Good job, eh? Nice to meet you, Pete. I'll see you in the all-day restaurant here. They don't call them coffee shops anymore. And you can buy me a coffee.
Sure.
Now, we can actually see outside now, beyond the construction materials. I have a complaint for you, Steve Halliday, and for you too, Mr. Gruder. We can't see the view for the sails.
Well, I tell you, you just have to look over this way and you can see the beautiful harbor, and over this way you can see the North Shore Mountains, but these beautiful Teflon sails, there's nothing we can do about it. We're just delighted that they're there because that's the statement.
Don't you think the sails itself are beautiful, something nice to look at?
Very impressive indeed, and I refuse to believe it's a copy in any way of the Sydney Opera House.
We say watch it, Sydney.
Come on, let's go.
When you see this suite, you'll move over here instead of staying on the island. Yep. This has got the view beat.
Much obliged, Bud. Thanks again.
Okay, Jack.
That was Bud Oben, O-B-E-N. He's not normally an elevator operator in the hotel sense. Not right, Bud? Let's go, Jack.
We're going to go to the suite.
Okay, Herb Gruder, which floor are we on now of the
hotel? This is the 8th floor of the hotel.
8th floor. What are you getting? All you got to do is put the floor in and dress up the walls.
Put the wallpaper on and we can check in our first guests.
And are we on a fancy floor with fancy suites?
Yes, there's a suite on this floor, Jack.
Just a minute. What are you doing, sir?
Cutting drywall trim, sir.
Drywall trim. You're a drywaller.
Right. Yes, sir.
Tell me, how do you fill in the gaps between the boards so that they don't, so you don't get a big line down them? How do you do it?
Very neatly.
Patience. Neatly. No. Your name?
Tom Jenkins.
Where are you from, Tommy?
Burnaby.
Which union are you in?
It's 12-something, I forget.
Good
and
enough.
I go to all the meetings.
Tell me, do you always wear your cap like that?
Yep. Have to, our boss is a pusher.
Much obliged, Tommy. Nice to meet you. Let's go, let's see my suite. Well, we're still on the 8th floor, quite obviously. We've got a long walk. How many?
Well, there's 33 rooms per floor, Jack, and one of the nice features that we're going to have in the hotel is an electronic lock system where we have a very good fire life safety system as well. So the rooms also have double doubles and large king size beds.
What's an electronic lock system?
Well, that means we can rekey your room if you lose your key in a matter of seconds by a computer at the front desk. So it's a very good system. We can rekey the whole hotel in a matter of 20 minutes.
By changing the combination of your computerized system.
And change each one of the keys.
Is this going to be super expensive for every room?
No, not really. The security feature is far outweighs the overall cost and the room rates, if that's what you mean.
Yeah,
it wasn't cheap. I tell you that.
No,
the room rates are comparable to the downtown quality hotels that Vancouver now has.
In other words, even with today's construction costs, you will keep the rate comparable to the other first class hotels.
Yes, sir.
Town.
Yes, sir.
But this will be the most first class, I'm sure
this
you'll tell me that.
This will be. You bet your bottom dollar it will be.
Am I in my suite now?
You're in your suite, Jack, and this is one of the nicest suites we have in the hotel. And this shows you a picture of the bedroom that will be in the suite.
But first of all, I'd like to walk around and view my patio and the scene above the sails.
Yes.
Oh,
you can see above it now.
Lovely, isn't it? Hey.
Feels like you're on a ship.
Five altogether.
It does, kind of, because that's the prow of the Canada Harbour Place ahead of us now, isn't it?
That's right. That's right, and these are the five Teflon sails.
It's like being on the bridge of a ship now.
Matter of fact, I can pretend I am the commander of the Pan Pacific Vancouver Hotel.
You are for today, Jack.
For this moment, in this suite.
That's right.
Tell me a secret. This suite has got this huge circular fronted...
Yes, this is a balcony.
Balcony.
Yes.
What else?
We've got a bedroom over on this side.
Right.
And we have another bedroom on this side.
And where's my whirlpool?
Well, the whirlpool's on the 23rd floor, and it has an elevated whirlpool with a sauna and a steam room and a grand piano in the suite.
Just by the way, I insist right now on room service. I don't care whether you're only half finished or a quarter finished. I want room service right now.
It's not quite time.
Well, where the hell did this come from?
Oh, here it is, all of a sudden. Klaus. How are you?
I'll be a cup of coffee.
How are you, Klaus?
Very well.
Have we met before, Klaus?
Yes, we have.
And your last name?
Schoenberg.
And your function, Klaus?
I work for Region V Kederath, and I'm serving you coffee today.
Good, good. You look very well for a man of your age.
Thank you.
Good. I'll have black coffee and a brownie.
Black coffee?
You sound like come right from our big shop, Jack.
That was excellent magic room service. The first room service in the Pan Pacific Vancouver Hotel.
That's right.
Cheers, best luck, gentlemen.
Cheers, best luck to you.
And in line with an old Scotch tradition, I'm about to christen with good luck, and I'll be back after this particular break. You know, on every floor of the World Trade Center and the Pan Pacific Hotel, wherever you look out the windows, you see the most incredible views of the sails. And actually, I'm just saying cheerio now to Stan, to Steve Halliday, because we're now in your Five Sails restaurant.
This is the Five Sails restaurant, our gourmet restaurant.
How many restaurants you got all together?
We've got three.
Got three.
That's right.
Steve, thank you very much, Jack.
We'll see you. See you January 9th, 1986.
For sure. Now, standing over here is an old friend of mine by the name of Alan Fowlis of the Board of Trade. What the devil are you doing here?
Well, this is going to be our new facilities, Jack. The Board of Trade is moving into the World Trade Center building, and we are having a World Trade Center club as well as the offices of the Vancouver Board of Trade and the World Trade Center, Vancouver.
So you are the sharp point of the big push for the Pacific Rim as far as the Board of Trade and business is concerned.
Yes, we're encouraging world trade, and that's the purpose of the World Trade Center.
Now, let me get something clear, just to keep everybody happy. Right next to us is the World Trade Center office building, which is how many floors?
Four floors altogether, and this is the first one. All right.
And this was built by the Tokyo Corporation.
Tokyo Canada Corporation, yes.
You built this and you built the Pan Pacific Hotel.
That is correct, yes.
And you manage the World Trade Center building, office building.
We have constructed and developed the hotel and the office building complex, which has become the World Trade Center, and we own it. And the Board of Trade is our anchor tenant, has given the name World Trade Center to this office building.
Well, you better bring some trade in from the Pacific Rim or we'll never forgive you.
All right. That's our aim in life.
And how do I become a member of your World Trade Center club?
Well, you become a member of the Vancouver Board of Trade, and that automatically gives you privileges to use the World Trade Center club.
Would that not make me into a stuffed shirt?
Oh, no.
Those days have gone out.
That's right.
Thanks very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Gooder. Thank you very much, Alan Fowlis. I'm now going to go out and get down in the convention center and see what our federal government has done or is doing for us. Hey, what was that you said just now?
I said, let's go. We got to get busy.
You did not. You said something else. You made a fool of my program. You said?
What? 9 a.m. precisely.
Not bad at all, eh? What's your name?
Jack Stevens.
Jack.
Ironworker.
Ironworker. Which local is that?
97.
And what did you shout over there, that fella?
That's my buddy. Hey. I didn't say a word.
Yes, you did.
I just said, is that Mrs. Webster's little boy? That's all.
How you doing?
Not too bad.
Tell me, you getting on with the job?
Oh, yes, Jack, we're doing fine.
You shouted to the crew, look busy, everybody. Webster's here, didn't you?
Yep.
Where are you from, Jack?
London.
London where?
Stepney.
You're a Cockney?
Aye.
Lost your bleeding accent. Get up them apples and pears.
Listen, Jack, you couldn't give yours away.
Hey, could you hold that noise a minute or two? Tell me this, how many of these do you break a day?
None.
Well, they're not made of glass then, they're made of plastic.
Yeah, correct.
Much obliged. Now, I'm meeting the key man in this whole development and operation, and his name is Ken Bream, and he is the president of Canada Harbour Place, and what's the spare hat for?
Jack, this is your Canada Place hat. Welcome to Canada Place.
I got to take off my Webster hat and put on my Canada Place hat. And I remember you from Pacific Center.
That's correct. You do.
Now, how is this going? I don't want any nonsense about it. What troubles have you got which will prevent you from opening for May the 2nd, 1986, the day the expo opens?
Jack, we don't really have any troubles. We're on time and we're on budget. We expect to have the basic construction finished about August 1st of this year.
Is there a basic lesson to be learned here, said he, not to nag or carp, in labor relations?
Well, I think there may be for a project of this size. We have gone union labor all the way, and we're very happy with the performance that union labor has had on this job. They have really been very productive, and we have no complaints.
And how's the productivity been? Good, you were telling me.
Productivity is excellent. We couldn't have asked for more.
Have you had any unofficial stoppage, wildcats, or anything?
None whatsoever. Not one day.
No. The figures are always impressive. When was it the federal government stepped in and took over the total project?
April 1, 1982.
And
the basic job started in June of 1983.
Right, so therefore...
There was no design, there was no nothing at that point. There was just simply an empty pier.
There was some talk about a glass slipper sometime before then.
That's correct, but this is a completely new project from that time.
Were the sales, did they come about as a result of an architectural competition, or did you just pick somebody for the job?
No, we picked somebody for the job, and the sales solution came after we had picked them.
And we've got to ask you who the architects were, because this is going to be talked about all over the bleeding world.
There are three firms involved. Two of them are Vancouver firms, Musson Cattell and Downs Archambault. And then the firm from Toronto is Zeidler Roberts Partnership.
And these are the stays for the roof?
These are the stays for the sail.
And did you have a wee crack at one of the sails, which I saw when I was over in the helicopter?
Yes, we certainly did. We had a very bad storm here last October, and during that storm, two of the sails were actually ripped, and we've since repaired them completely. And we don't expect it to happen again because they're now tied firmly down.
They weren't fully cinched down at that particular time.
Right.
Is that the same stuff as a stadium roof?
Yes, it is.
Same stuff.
Fiberglass covered with Teflon.
Yeah, but it doesn't move in the wind now
at all. It does not move. No, it's in place and will stay in place.
Okay, Ken, we're now strolling along the west promenade deck outside the convention center. Is that right?
That's correct. As I say, it's 30 feet wide. It's open to the public year-round, 7 days a week. There's landscaping, a number of planters on the west side.
These are planters.
These are planters. There's public seating interspersed with the planters. There's a ship's deck on the ship's railing on the west side again. And then on the east side, there's a canopy which provides covered access all the way to the far end of the pier.
Now, a silly question, but this is where the cruise ships come in.
This is where the cruise ships come in, and the public will assemble here and look down on the cruise ship passengers coming in on a lower level in the cruise ship facility.
Oh, was somebody telling me that the ships have got bigger and you won't be able to dock as many cruise ships as you had previously thought?
That's right. Some of the cruise ships now are taking as many as 1,300 passengers, and as a result, at one time, we'll only be able to have two of the largest cruise ships, but if we have the smaller size, we'll have as many as five at one time.
Is that a fault of any kind? It wouldn't seem to be.
No, it's not a fault at all. And of course, with the larger cruise ships, there are fewer of them required.
What are these little booths to the side here?
These are food facilities for the public. There'll be five of them altogether along this west promenade. They will serve food out to the public in the good months. They'll also be serving into the convention center year-round.
So really, on the west promenade deck now, if we go over here, if they're in full operation, we can go over here and we can wave to Auntie Maisie, who's coming in from Sydney, Australia, or from London.
Exactly.
Down at the water ships, level.
Cruise ships will be docking right here, and as I say, there's as many as 1,300 people coming off one of these ships into the cruise ship facility, which is one level down.
Old Pier BC wouldn't know itself anymore, would it?
That's for sure.
Was this the pier? No, Ballantyne burned down. Did this burn down too?
No, this was demolished in 1980.
In 1980. One question on money. What was your allowable targeted figure for the federal expenses on this operation?
$144.8 million.
How many hundred millions are going to be over?
We're going to be under that budget.
Under that budget?
Under that budget, yes, sir.
Good stuff. Now let's go. We're now going to go into the convention center.
Correct.
Oh, just before we go inside, Ken, I want to interrupt these two chaps. Hey, hold it, boys. Hold it. Hold it. Name, please.
Paul Ng.
Paul Ng, how long have you been working on the job, Paul?
A week.
A week?
Yes.
Were you out of work before then?
Yeah, I was out of work.
How long?
About 10 months.
10 months. Gary Dibble.
Yes, precisely, Jack.
Nice to meet you, Gary.
Pleased to meet you, Jack.
How long have you been working on the job here?
I've been on for about 4 months now, Jack.
Good job?
Yeah, it's a good job.
Your union is what?
What's it? The Carpenters Local 452.
You too, 452?
Yes, me too. Yes.
Okay.
Webster, we'll be right back after this break.
Excellent. Say it again.
Webster will be right back after the break.
Okay, Ken, we're now in the convention center.
That's correct, Jack. We're in the convention center. It's one of the largest convention centers in North America. It's over 100,000 square feet of exhibit hall space that we're in at the moment. What we missed earlier was the ballroom, which leads into this space. We can accommodate as many as 7,000 people to sit down dinner in this space.
In this space in here?
In this space in here, 7,000 people.
7,000 people?
10,000 people at a trade show or something like that.
Now, let me get this quite clear. This is the permanent convention center that we're in now of Canada Harbour Place.
That's correct, and during Expo it will be used as the Canada Pavilion, but it's immediately after that it will be converted into an operating trade and convention center.
I know. Now, we've got to meet somebody here to tell us what they're going to do during Expo.
That's correct. I'd like you to meet Norm Hay, who is the creative director for Expo for the Canada Pavilion.
How do you do?
Norman Hay.
How do you do?
H-A-Y.
H-A-Y. You Scott's name.
Yeah, you are the creative. There are Hayes in our family. They come from the Orkneys. And you are the creative guy.
Creative director.
So what you've done is you've planned this pavilion for Expo.
Well, a lot of planning was done when I came on board, and I'm working with the concept for
okay.
the...
Okay. Now, wave your magic wand and tell me what I'll see when you have finished your work ready for the opening of Expo on May the 2nd, 1986.
Well, you're standing in the Great Hall, as we call it.
Uh-huh.
And this is the area where the visitor sees is underneath this roof and gets the whole feeling of the pavilion.
It really is very impressive, isn't it?
It's extraordinary. But before you got here, you came through three theaters.
Right.
You queued, you came on the East Promenade, you entered a queue area where you were entertained by a goose and a beaver.
By a which?
A goose and a beaver.
A goose and a beaver.
An actor is a goose and an actor is a beaver, right? And their dialogue will be by the fact that they were here long before any of us were here. They have an overview.
Right.
They saw the natives cross the Bering Sea. They saw the first explorers. They saw the trains come. They've seen everything. And so they give a perspective on the history of Canada. Then you enter three theaters. And the first theater celebrates the fact that we're in Canada and we are Canadians. The second theater begins to give the new perspective that we're underlining throughout the whole pavilion, that is Canada in a new dimension of the space above, the atmosphere, the earth, and below, and the fact that we are surrounded by water, the Pacific, the Arctic, the Atlantic, the Lawrence Seaway, and the Great Lakes. And that we are also being very innovative in space and very innovative underneath the water. And so that is introduced to you in a theatrical way, first of all. Then you come in here into the Great Hall, and there are two levels. You walk around here on the 15-foot level.
Uh-huh.
And then you come down and through the Arctic, which is the only region we're touching regionally. Otherwise, it's all integrated. And then you get the opportunity to walk underneath huge mirror surfaces in here, where we have the hardware and the hands-on and the interactive and the hard-nosed stuff and the real tight information.
Give me that again. The hardware and the hands-on and the real interaction. Hardware, I can understand. Yeah. The hands-on, what's that?
Well, the hardware is where, the hands-on is where you push something on the hardware.
And it happens.
And it happens, yeah.
And the interactive.
Or it gives you an answer, you know.
What would you call it? Communications, scientific, technological demonstration.
It's technology which is demonstrating the transportation and communication theme, which are, in Canada, are so closely linked. Mm-hmm. One is totally related.
And you're
going to
use the whole 100,000 square feet for this?
Well, this whole area we're using.
Yeah.
We're using it all.
Anything else that I should know about now?
Well, after you leave,
what would it cost to do to fit up the pavilion?
We're not allowed to talk about money. We're not allowed to talk about money.
Not allowed to talk about money.
No.
Norman, what did you do before this?
I was creative director of the Ontario Pavilion.
Oh.
And I got it to a stage where I felt I could leave it. And I keep my eye on it, though they're not supposed to know that, but I do. And it's going very well. I'm very happy about it.
You're happy?
I'm very happy, yeah.
Extraordinarily
yeah.
proud of what we're going to see. If it's a kind of Canada's future. It's a little of Canada's past, but Canada's future for Expo 86.
That's right, and I think it's going to be wonderful. Just wonderful.
My thanks to Norm Hay, creative director. Not any more creative than I am, but he's smarter at it. Isn't that right? Thank you very much, Norm.
Thank you.
Well, I've just suddenly discovered a little amphitheater at the close to the sharp end of the convention center. What's that big round building up there, Ken?
Jack, that is the CN IMAX theater. That's a theater that will seat about 550 people. It's got an enormous screen.
IMAX?
IMAX, which means maximum image theater. It's a very large screen. It's known as total involvement theater.
A glass elevator goes up to it.
That's a glass elevator that serves down to the parking levels and serves the four or five public levels at the same.
Parking below this?
Parking below.
Public parking?
Public parking, two levels below.
What's this amphitheater we're in?
The amphitheater is basically a public observation area, but it also, during Expo, during the performance, during the 6 months of Expo, will be the Canadian Pavilion area. It will basically be live performances in here, and we can accommodate about 1,500 people sitting and standing.
Where are we going now?
We're going into the restaurant, which is just over on our right. This is a public restaurant. It seats about 300 people, and we've just gone through a public competition for this restaurant, and we've awarded the contract for it.
Good. Now we're going to go up in the top and prow of the ship.
We call this area the prow, and at the top end there's a public observation deck that gives a magnificent view.
Let's go. Let's go. Squeeze past Paul. Just squeeze past him. Don't knock him over unless you have to. And so we say farewell to the first walkabout that Webster has done at Canada Harbour Place. And we've got good old RBC taking off. And we've got the Constitution coming. Wave. Come on, wave. Wave. Wait, that's better. Wave. Wave, wave. Little do they know it, but they'll be here as of May the 2nd, 1986, to take part in Expo, and on this occasion, particularly Canada Harbour Place, which is going to be the Canada Pavilion, and after that, a convention centre. And I'll just take a delicate little walk around the outside edge and have a look at CN's IMAX Theatre, the sales, the Pan Pacific Hotel, the World Trade Center, and they veritably assure me that it's on time, on budget, on target, and will and must be, along with Expo 86, be a great and riotous success.
I got more souvenir safety helmets than you could drop a couple of steel beams on, I'll tell you. This one says Webster, 9 a.m. precisely. However, that was good. I must say I enjoyed that. I'm not normally enthusiastic about expenditure of public money for conventions and whatnot, but I was very impressed with the tour of BC Place. It's a massive thing, and it's on target, on time, and on budget. Something must have gone wrong. One thing I didn't explore in detail, but you'll learn all about it as it opens, when was Norman Hay, who was a charming fella, was telling me that in the entrance to the Expo display, that's the Canada Pavilion, that there's going to be a goose and a beaver. Now, I think that's going to be a live goose and a live beaver. Eh? Steve, my producer, my co-producer, tells me that they're going to be actors. Ach, I don't believe that. He says there's going to be actors dressed up as geeses and beavers. One goose, two geese. One moose, two meese. Anyway, we've time for a free-for-all. And I'm prepared to be quite serious this morning. We want to be serious in a free-for-all. I was quite impressed with little Stephen Lewis. He's certainly slick. And Bernie Simpson, who runs Harcourt's, or is one of the principal operators of the Harcourt Famine Relief Fund, made an anguished plea for me to try and get people who can afford to donate to the City Hall Family Relief Fund by sending a check to Mayor Harcourt at the City Hall in trust for the fund. Okay, I'm going to have a free-for-all. Where shall I go? Good morning.
Oh, yeah, when you were at Canada Place, did they show you in the area where you had parked the 35 to 40 tour buses that are going to be needed to take the people around?
parking for tour buses to take the people around. Why would you need 35 to 40 buses? There's going to be a transit level at the pier side, at the level below the balcony I was walking on, but I didn't specifically ask about parking. I am sorry.
Well, I've understood that there's only going to be about 10 spots, and go down to Ballantyne Pier any summer day and you'll see how many are needed.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Well, there's a fair amount of room underneath that pier, and it's all the open reception area for the people off the cruise ship, so presumably they have half-decent parking there. Next time I'm down, I'll have a look and I'll ask a question for you. Thanks very much. Go ahead, please. Hello. Why, my. Go ahead from Aldergrove instead. Go ahead.
Yeah, Jack. Something I wanted to make you aware of is that we've got a problem out here. They're planning to put a landfill out here, the Lower Mainland Refuge Project, and I was just wondering if you had any plans of having a show about that. We're quite worked up about it out here.
I've seen a fair amount of material and a fair amount of coverage on it, on the landfill. Is that a commercial proposition or is that the GVRD?
It's a new entity called the Lower Mainland Refuge Project. It's a combination of the three regional districts, Dude-Ni-Alouette, Central Fraser Valley, and GVRD. And ultimately, it may even involve the provincial government.
I saw that. Why are you worried about it?
Well, the areas that they've got four designated areas for the dumps, and one is basically not 400 or 500 acres of farmland, and the other two areas, well, two of them actually are farmland. One's a cranberry farm. The other two areas are right on top of, right down by the border, on top of water systems. We've got groundwater in Langley. We also, the people in Blaine have...
Well, I'll tell you what, I'll put it on my list. Lower Mainland, what do you call it?
Refuge Project.
We'll see what we can find out about it. Go ahead from the Gulf Islands.
Good morning, Mr. Webster.
Morning, ma'am.
Just wanting to know what you thought of the prepaid reservations to the Gulf Islands.
There is a new reservation system for the Gulf Islands, which in some ways is an improvement. And when they refine it, it might be quite useful. What they have done...
Oh, I know.
I know, but I'm telling other people what they have done. And the fact was it had to be done because of all these damn people who made blanket reservations through the year, which they were allowed to do for, as you and I know, a 6 weeks or 8 week period, and then they didn't show. All these people who didn't cancel the reservations. I'm in favor of a prepaid reservation system, but the way it's being done at the moment, I phoned up this morning and I got a reservation, I put it on my Visa charge, and I'll go along tonight when I come back Sunday, and I'll have to sign a little slip that that's my reservation and my Visa charge. I think they could simplify it a bit more by taking your word for it on the basis of your license plates, because the number of people who would cheat on the visa would be very few indeed, or the number of visas that would bounce would be very few indeed. I think it's a brave effort. I don't think it's quite refined yet, but I'm glad they're trying it.
They certainly haven't got it, the crinks out of it yet. I gave them $324 a week ago Tuesday and went to get on the ferry Wednesday night, and there was five of us that were prepaid. And they had to hold the ferry up because they didn't know where our tickets were. We weren't on the manifest. It was just like a zoo.
Oh, that's a bad one. Well, you see, I've only made two reservations so far, and there was a bit of delay last week because the guy had to check you off against your reservation, but it was only a 10-minute delay.
Well, then they wanted us to sign a thing that we'd lost our tickets. We haven't received our tickets. They still don't know where our tickets are. They think they're in the mail.
Well, I had an option, too, of signing for a lost ticket or not received ticket, not a sign for a not received ticket, and I don't see why that... But you had a further error in that the computer didn't show your license number.
Didn't show any of us.
Well, it showed my license number last Sunday and hopefully it showed this Sunday, but where did you pay the $324?
When the reservations opened a week ago Tuesday at 10 after 7, I got through to the Vancouver and I gave them my master charge and... for $324, which was approved. Wednesday afternoon before I came over, they said, there'll be no problem. Your name will be on the list, et cetera, et cetera. And I get out there, and it was just crazy.
Have they found it since?
Well, not yet. Yesterday I phoned again reservations, and they've given me a voucher number to get home on Sunday night.
You've got a voucher. Maybe they should give us a number when we make the reservation on the phone, tell you your number is 456B or something.
Well, that's what they have given me to get home Sunday night because they still don't know where my tickets are.
I'll see you on the ferry Sunday. Let me know how you're getting on then.
Are you on Sunday night?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, see you Sunday.
Okie dokie.
Thanks.
Bye. Take a break. That means take a break. Go ahead, please.
Good morning.
Morning.
George, your show this morning is saying, why don't you, after you come back from your six-month summer sabbatical, take your show on the road and go to the Southern California area for a week or so and do your show live from California. You can get some very high-profile people on there. You should be able to get a telephone hookup so people here can question them. But if there's 40 million people between here and Mexico, and if we don't crack that market for Expo, we're in a lot of trouble.
Matter of fact, they need somebody like me in California this summer chatting up and talking up and talking up Expo.
And chat it up, sure.
But they haven't got anybody like me to go down and do a good selling job. The only trouble is I'd have to bury all my cynical views about everything else and become the perfect overseas export Canadian. And that's kind of difficult for me.
Well, yeah, but you'd only have to do it for a week or so.
I think
you're a good man for that type of exposure, and I'm sure you'd get some funding out of the government. No.
Wouldn't take any payola from social credit if my life depended on it.
Okay, but I think you should try it.
It's a good idea, as a matter of fact, but I don't know. Go down to California.
Well, yeah, but you've got to remember, you see, there's as much population there is in all of Canada, and then you take the rest of the states that are on the west.
No, but to do that, you'd have to go down and you'd have to do the chat show circuit in California.
Right.
I'd have to con myself onto every radio and television talk show.
Do it live from down there with your own show. I mean,
but I'd have to be nice all the time.
Pardon?
I'd have to be nice all the time.
Canadian television down there is like watching World War I movies in Timbuktu. I mean, we're nothing down there, and you got to crack it.
I don't have to crack it. I know you're a bit of a fink. Do I know you?
No. Not at all, but I enjoy your show. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Go ahead from where is Englemont? Let me think. Don't tell me. Englemont. Where is it?
On the Shoe Swap Lake.
Shoe Swap. Goody, goody. Go ahead.
Best place in the world.
Right.
Right. I was like wanting to know, Jack, about this immigration. Is there ever going to be a chance that they'll change the laws there that so when a person comes into this country, that if there's any criminal things they're caught in, that they could be deported?
I've been campaigning about this for years until I began to sound like a racist, which I don't like to do. But the regulations allowing family unification in this country are absolutely riddled with loopholes and potentials for graft and corruption in the largest degree.
Yeah,
and the other thing to which I object strongly and always have objected strongly is that when you land here as an immigrant, you automatically become a Canadian citizen within 3 years, regardless.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it used to be 5 years, and you had to apply for citizenship, right. And the country here decided whether or not you were good enough to get it.
Yeah,
but
right.
Due to the fact that politicians of all stripes, particularly those in power, liberal and conservative in Ottawa, will do anything, bend any law, stretch any allowance, to make sure they've got ethnic bloc voting,
right, yep.
Nothing will be done to clean up the scandals in our immigration policy. Now, I'm not complaining about refugees,
no.
Although why we should bring in people who turn out to be refugees who want to smash another country working in from here, I'm damned if I know.
Yeah. But I feel that anybody coming in here should at least sign some kind of a paper that if they're ever caught in anything illegal, that they could be deported without any horsing around like they do now.
Yeah, there should be. At the moment, the automatic citizenship is far too soft, the unification is far too full of holes, and it's time we wakened up and began to treat, to look after ourselves a little bit. And I'll be back after the break.
Hey.
Well, tell the people up country the bad news in case they missed it. It's been snowing like the devil all around the lower mainland this morning. Absolutely disgraceful, quite intolerable, and it's Bill Bennett's fault. And Mulroney's fault. Would you stop giggling, Reuben? We've got a cameraman who suffers from terminal giggles. Really, stop it, Reuben. Tom Waterland, Minister of Forests on Forest Policy, on Monday morning, at 9 a.m. precisely. People thought that old Webster would fall on his face on television, but he fooled everybody by being the riot of success, which he still is on a good day. Lotteries are a rip-off for the rich and a tax for the poor, and I am totally and absolutely 100% completely to the rest of my days against that form of South American program. Banana Republic taxation.
And I think it would be better if you, and especially Bill Bennett and all his minions and flocks and hacks, would just go down to Arizona and leave the government of British Columbia into a blind trust. Thank you.
Put him down as doubtful in the next election.
We've got the most extreme right-wing loony fringe government here that anybody's got in the world. And
oh, outside of Central America. Excellent. Say it again.
Webster will be right back after the break.
You made a fool of my program. You said?
What? 9 a.m. precisely.
Don't miss my walkabout at Canada Harbour Place on check at midnight. What is Tom Waterland, Forest Minister, going to do about our trees? 9 a.m.? No. Sorry, muffed it. Too long. Has Tom Waterland really got a forest, reforest, forest, forest, reforest, forest, forest? Okay, I got it. Tom Waterland on his so-called reforestation policy, Monday, 9 a.m. precisely. Tom Waterland's 5-year plan for our forests, Monday, 9 a.m. precisely.